Good afternoon and welcome to today's webinar on using recycled organics as a partial replacement for peat in casing. My name is Jenny Ekman, I'm from Applied Horticultural Research and I'll be moderating the webinar today. We are joined by Graham Price and our presenter Adam Goldwater. Graham will be familiar to many of you as he's been growing mushrooms since well before Noah was even in short pants. Adam has been running the Marsh Lawson Mushroom Research Unit for some years now and has gained a wealth of knowledge about mushroom growing through this, as well as other mushroom related projects which we've been conducting at AHR. He recently did this series of studies with recycled organics that we're going to hear about today. The webinar is being recorded and we will send a link of the recording to everyone who has registered. Please feel free to share this link with anyone else that you think may be interested in this information. And as an acknowledgement, this project was funded through the Waste Less, Recycle More initiative, funded through the Waste Levy by the New South Wales Government. Over to you, Adam.
Thank you very much, Jenny. Thank you everyone for joining us this afternoon, or if it's still morning in some parts of Australia.
That's true.
So, a bit of background about what we were doing with these trials on recycled organics. So what we were looking at was some sort of partial replacement for peat in the casing material. So in Australia, about 25,000 tonnes of peat casing is used in mushroom production per year. And it's imported at quite a cost from places like Europe and Canada. And it's not only expensive, but it's also quite a unsustainable practice because peatlands themselves, they store quite a lot of carbon, and draining those peatlands releases quite an amount of greenhouse gas. And in fact, 10% of all greenhouse gas emissions from agriculture, fisheries, and forestry actually come from draining of peatlands. So if a government was looking to try and reduce their carbon emissions, they'd probably pick this as quite an easy target to, you know, have quite an impact. And as a result, peat extraction may become increasingly limited. So we may see fewer countries extracting it, price may increase. So it's clearly a risk to the industry. So what we looked at was recycled organics compost. So it's about a third the price of peat, approximately, depending on suppliers, what the product's like, and it's locally available. So all the major cities in Australia have composting facilities. We'll come to those later on. And it's something that's typically used in landscaping. So the sort of things that you put in your garden and landscapers would use widely. And it is used in agriculture and food production. So the availability of these sort of products, well, there's plenty of it available and it's increasing. So just in New South Wales alone, I could only find figures back in 2012, but it was about 1 million cubic metres a year produced just in New South Wales back in 2012. So that's no doubt increased and will continue to increase. So there should be plenty of this available for the amount that's actually required by the mushroom industry in Australia. And looking at what work's been done on this already, well, Ralph Noble, who's based over in the UK, he's a researcher there, some of you may know, and he's tried blends of recycled organics blended with peat in the UK. And what he found there was he got 12.5% recycled organics blended in with the peat, and that didn't reduce yields. When he went higher than that, he started to see yields decline. So we thought, well, let's give it a crack and see if we can up that and try and beat them and see if you know, the feedstocks here, they're different to the UK and also composting procedures. So let's see if we can get past that 12.5% to make it something that industry can use. So the trials we did, so we were evaluating the blends of recycled organics compost mixed in with peat as an alternative to the pure peat casing. And we had three trials conducted this year from January to August down at the Marsh Lawson Mushroom Research Unit, bit of a mouthful, that's based at the University of Sydney. And so here's a picture of one of our trials set up with some lovely mushrooms on the beds there. So what we did to start with, we looked at a physical and chemical analysis of peat, just to see what do we try and have to match here to get the same sort of characteristics, and what's going to be quite different in the recycled organics. So we have a look at pH. The peat, we were looking at about 7.5, and the recycled organics, so this is from three different batches that we used in our three different trials. We had three quite different batches of compost, and you see there we've got pretty similar pH, slightly neutral or slightly alkaline there. In terms of available nitrogen, we've got very low nitrogen level in our peat, and in our recycled organics compost, in one case we had quite similar, in another case we had quite a lot higher, and that was a difference in the age of the compost. So we sort of purposely tried some less aged product to start, more aged to start with, so a finer, more broken down compost, and then we tried something a bit coarser and less aged.
So all three of the different types of materials were quite different, like obviously to the eye.
That's right, yeah, you could see yeah. Differences, and we thought, well, this is good, like if we can get all three of these working, then that sort of solves an issue of differences in material. I mean, ideally you'd have consistency.
Yeah.
That's what you'd be working towards. But in this case, to demonstrate the viability of this product, it was sort of a good thing.
So I imagine that the growers would be really concerned about not having a consistent product. But perhaps if we found that they're quite different each time, but you can find similar results, then that's a really positive.
Absolutely, we'll come to those results soon. So with our total water holding capacity, so peat, as we know, holds plenty of water, 76%, and our recycled organics compost was slightly lower, but not all that much lower. So, it's a very important characteristic that it can hold enough water like peat. Now, our salt content, this is something that's been reported as often limiting to getting similar yields to peat is higher salt content. So this is presented as the EC, electrical conductivity, so 0.4 for our peat. And in our recycled organics, we've got around 2 to 2.4, so it's a lot higher. And we thought, well, this could be a limiting thing. And what we tried in a couple of trials was actually trying to flush some of those salts out. So that's what we mean by leach. So we literally put it in a tub, tipped some water in with it, mixed it around, and then flushed that out. And we did that three times. So we only left it for sort of a few minutes in between each time we flushed it. This may be something, there may be a way to do that commercially rather than mixing it up in a little tub. But it was a good, the good thing is that we have actually reduced that EC by about half. So that's something to note when we come to looking at our results.
So some of the overseas trials, which have also looked at leaching, I think have taken, it's been put out in the field for months and months and just let rain do it, or they've done it actively for several days in a row. But this is quite a small amount of leaching, and yet you've already reduce the EC by half, so it shows it's quite a doable thing, mm-hmm. Perhaps.
Yeah. And in terms of airfill porosity, so that's air spaces inside the casing, which is important for a gas exchange from the compost through to the air. Peat sitting at about 11%, and our recycled organics compost varied quite a lot, from 10 up to 35%, but again, we see these differences in the material, but we'll come to whether that's actually had an impact on yield based on, three quite different products that we've used. So just a bit more on the method before we get to those results. So the recycled organics compost was produced by Australian Native Landscapes, and that was produced by, according to the Australian Standard 4454. Which is used for producing compost to a certified standard. That means it's safe for producing food, which is quite important if you've got something like a mushroom, which is in contact with that compost. And so what we did was we pasteurized most of that compost in addition to the procedure that was already done at A&L. So this was once we got the material and back to the mushroom unit, and we actually repasteurized it just in case there was any fungal pathogens in there, which we might have introduced. But to check if that was actually a problem, we left a couple of beds, we left as one treatment, we left unpasteurized just to check. We added water to it, so it's typically a lot drier than the peat that you would be purchasing for mushroom production. So from 50%, we increased it up to about 75% moisture. And I guess this is a bit about the three different products that we used. First trial, we had quite a fine, mature product. The second trial, it was much more coarse and less mature, less broken down. And the third one we had was quite fine, and it was also slightly gritty, so there might have been some sand or something in there. So it was all three were quite different, which we thought was interesting to try. See what, you know, if we can get consistency out of all those three, well then that's a good thing. So we cased with top tier of peat moss and blended in our recycled organics with that, casing three phase three compost bags as you would commercially. And we had four replicates, so four of the bags per trial for each treatment. And when we picked them at the cup stage and targeting that sort of 40 to 50 millimeter size, and that was across three flushes. Okay, so our treatments, so with our control, obviously, the standard commercial practice of just peat. Then we had a 25% blend, so we wanted to try and get well past that 12.5% that Ralph had tried, and we thought, well, let's see how we go. So we had that. So these are they're all pasteurized except for this one. 25% we left unpasteurized, 50% blend, and then we had our 50% blend which had been leached, so we'd flushed some of that salt out. And then we thought, well, in our third trial, we thought, let's try 75%, and in our first trial we were super keen, we tried 100%. So we'll show you that now. So our results, the photos sort of show it quite well. You look at our peat only on the left here and our 25% compost, very similar. It's hard to tell the difference between those. So this is our second flush in the first trial. And then this 50%, you can see, perhaps a slight decline there in yield. 100%, there's a very clear decline there. So
this is from the first trial, is that correct?
Well, actually, the 100% here would be I think these are all from our first trial. Yep. Yep. We'll come to the data on those. But I thought the photos of those, they sort of demonstrate the point that you've got, between the peat and the 25%, very similar, and then it sort of starts to decline off at 50% and certainly by 100%. Okay, so this is our total yield across the three flushes for the first trial, and we've got between peat 25%, the one that was pasteurized, and our unpasteurized 25%, there's very little difference between those. So even though this one's slightly higher, when we analyze that statistically, it's the same as these two. So that, we thought that this is a great result. Our first try, we've got 25% working pretty well. That's fantastic. And then obviously we've got this quite steep drop off here with our 50% and 100%. So what we thought was, why not try something that we can try and get that 50% working better? We'll drop this 100% for now because that's a long way off, but let's see if we can lift this up somehow. And what we did was we flushed those salts out. So this is the trial two results. So we decided, okay, let's try and flush those salts out. And hey, look at this. We've got very, very good yield here on our 50% that's been leached. So that's right on par with our control, our peat. Whereas, we've still got that drop off here with with 50% when it hasn't had those salts flushed out. So,
That looks like that is actually a significant difference between the leached and the non-leached in the 50%.
Yeah, that's right. So, and again, our 25% blends, they're statistically, they're no different from our peat only. So, so we thought, right, let's just, got ahead of myself there. So we thought let's try and repeat this, because this is a great result. If we're getting this 50% blend working, let's try it once more and see if we can get the same result. So here we go with trial three. And fantastic thing here was that we did get a very similar result, almost identical. I couldn't believe it. So this 50% leached, again, very similar to the peat. 50% was when it wasn't leached, it was slightly down. Our 25% blends here, again, very similar to the peat. We tried a 75% just to see what would happen, and that's down slightly as well from our control. So what we thought from this was, well, we've got two quite nice results here in the 25% and also this 50% when we flush some of that salt out. So if we combine those yields from each trial, so we've got in the blue trial one, the red is trial two, and green trial three. And so the thing here to note, I guess, is that our 25% blend has worked very well as that 50% leached. The other thing is that we've used very different recycled organic composts in these trials, each trial. And you look here at some of these, the consistency between the trials is very, very consistent yield. So, there are slight differences in some of them, particularly this one. But, here we've got consistency, here we've got very consistent yields, despite using very different casing material. So that was
very. And it's promising too that the unpasteurized one, like not pasteurizing it, mm-hmm. has not had any negative impact. Mm-hmm. You didn't see any weed molds on those beds.
So we kept an eye out for disease on those beds, and we didn't see anything. So that was particularly impressive. So going forward from that, we probably wouldn't do that extra pasteurizing step.
I guess it is actually pasteurized during the composting process. So
yeah,
that would be killing off any microbes that are in that compost.
Mm-hmm.
So it's only the concern about what might happen to it between the compost yard and the farmers, what would be your concern.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. All right, so now we've got a quick video of what we actually saw. So this is in trial two, and this is coming into the third flush. So when you expect, sort of poorer quality mushrooms, we're quite impressed with the main thing here is the quality was really no different across the three different treatments that we're going to show you here.
We're just coming into the third flush here, and this is a 25% recycled organics blend. You can see here we've got nice spread across the bed. We've got nice quality here. And if we compare this with a 50% recycled organics in the bed next to it, you can see there's really little difference in the spread in the number of caps on the bed. So we've really got little difference here between our 25 and our 50%. Here we've got our peat only casing. So this really is very similar again to our 25 and our 50% recycled organics. So this is sort of the standard practice, and we've got similar to the other treatments. We've got nice spread across the bed, nice quality, and just sizing up nicely for our picking in the third flush.
Yeah, beautiful quality mushrooms there, Adam.
Well, that goes to Graham, I think, for growing a superb crop. So we'll come to Graham towards the end and get some comments on what he thought the quality was like. So just looking at the size of the mushrooms we picked, so these are broken into diameter classes of the mushrooms. So the main thing here, I guess, is that we haven't altered the size profile significantly with any of these treatments. You might say that this 50% leached treatment we've got a bit more in that 40 to 50 millimeter class, which is not a bad thing. That's probably what you're sort of targeting. But the main thing is that we haven't suddenly shifted to a much smaller or larger mushroom because of using these different casing materials. Okay, so what's the potential for mushroom growers and in terms of cost saving? So if you base, I've sort of picked 40 litres of casing per metre squared, so just for calculation's sake. So if we look at recycled organics, you're looking at roughly somewhere around $50 a metre cubed, and you compare that with peat, about three times that. So if you're looking at a pure peat casing, you're sort of talking $6 a metre squared. If you're able to get a 50% blend working, then you're going to have only $4 a metre squared. So 33% saving, which, yeah, that's significant. And while peat might not be the largest cost at all by any means in a mushroom growing business, it's certainly still a cost. And not only that, the cost of peat may start to rise, you know, as availability may come into issues.
So. I mean, margins are very slim on mushrooms under the current circumstances. Yes. So any reduction in cost, I think, would be a benefit to growers.
Absolutely.
And improving environmental sustainability of production. Mm-hmm. So some of that sort of green points.
Yep. Yeah. So I guess where to from here? So I think if you know, growers wanted to try some of these products on their farms, taking a small area and trying that 25% recycled organics blend to start with, that's a good start. And I guess the thing to note is that while we've tried three products, three different recycled organics products from one supplier, there are a number of suppliers out there and their products may differ. So you know, trying some of those would be good to look at. And then if we could create some sort of specification for what's the sort of optimal blend, that would be great as well. And I guess another thing would be trying to get past that 25%, looking at how can we, you know, there's some good ways that we can do that flushing of salt out of the compost or produce something with a lower salt content and try and push up to that 50%, perhaps try even a 75-100% with lower salt content. So I think there's a lot of promising work in this.
Mm.
And if you're looking for a compost supplier, so this is recycled organics compost suppliers, not phase three compost. So the best way to look is there's a directory on the Australian Organics Recycling Association website. So what you can look up on their website, there's a directory, look up your area, and what you'd be looking for is a product which is you know, a consistent product, it's compliant with that AS4454, which means it's safe to use for food production, and also you'd want to get an analysis of the mm-hmm. product. So there's a number of different suppliers out there. Okay, and so that's the end of my presentation today, and I'd encourage anyone to enter some questions into the question box.
Yes, so please ask questions. You can just type them in, and they'll pop up on the screen here, and we can ask Adam.
Yeah. More. So coming up next week, same time, so you've got Jenny Ekman next week. So she's going to be talking about reviewing the factors that improve mushroom whiteness. So. Interesting work that Jenny's been doing recently on that. And so we can send the registration link out to you all after this.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right.
So I might just jump out of the hot seat for Graham to make some comments on the quality that he saw.
All right. So Graham?
Yes, Jenny.
Welcome, Graham.
Thank you.
So Grant, you're the professional mushroom grower. What did you think of the trial?
Well, what I found was that towards the end of each break, peat moss seemed to fail. The mushrooms were inclined to be a bit on the spongy side and they wanted to open early. But on the recycled material, the mushrooms held their quality. They were hard and I feel that they were whiter in quality. And it took a bit of getting used to. I found there was a bit of overpinning occurring on second break. So what we did to overcome that, we brought the crop in and grew it at 20 degrees air temperature. When we got overpinning on second break, we went to 27 degrees for an hour and a half and dropped back to 20 degrees. That pruned the crop and it gave us very, very good yield.
So one of the things we didn't do in this trial was really look at the quality attributes of the mushrooms, but you felt that there was an improvement.
A definite improvement. Mm-hmm. I did the picking for me.
Yes. So if we were going to repeat this again, I think we should be measuring that, like some density, perhaps.
I think the density would be a good one to measure, and I think the analysis of the actual mushroom would be very good to just see if we're able to increase the nutrient and the any trace elements in the mushroom.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. So you thought that this was a really promising area.
I've got a couple of growers that are waiting to get green waste to start trialing.
Yeah, no, that's really promising. Mm. So, okay, so we've got some questions here.
Oh, great.
Excuse me while I just try that. Okay, so how old was the spent mushroom compost? No, it's not spent mushroom compost. This was recycled organics.
Recycled green waste.
Yeah. This is recycled green waste from curbside collections and also landscapers. So this was certainly nothing to do with mushroom compost. Yeah, it was just that green waste which had been recycled, and it's similar to those products like your compost and things that you buy at Bunnings. That's the sort of product.
So Jeff has asked, if you take into account the cost involved in leaching, how then does a 50% recycled blend compared with imported casing? Tricky question.
Yeah, well, it's a good point. Like, how would you go about doing that leaching? And perhaps we did it that way to try and demonstrate the point, I guess, that if you have a lower salt content material, then how does that compare? There may be other ways to try and produce a product with a lower salt content, there might be an efficient way to do that. But yep, you're right. It's a cost to be considered. And
So Michael has asked, how much water was added to leach out the salt? How much did you cover it?
Yeah, so we just completely covered the material. So completely flooded it with water and then drained it out and then flushed it again. So did the same again, filled it right up, flushed that out.
So I guess you're using three times the volume of the material itself in water in order to flush it.
Yeah.
But then you needed to add some moisture to bring it up, bring up the water content anyway, because it was initially a little dry.
That's right. Yeah.
So,
yep.
So that's some of that. Brian asks, has this recycled organics product been conducted using spent mushroom compost? No. No, so not spent mushroom compost. There's been a lot of work done on spent mushroom compost as part of casing, and it definitely, we know it works from other countries, but in this case, we're using fresh material. Carmen has asked, who does the leaching, the supplier or the end user? Well,
there's a question. That's a good question. I mean, if there is a good demand for this sort of product, I'm sure there'd be some suppliers that would look at doing something like that potentially. But it's something where I guess it depends on the demand for such a product.
So Carmen has also asked, how is the product mixed with the peat? So how did you blend them together?
In a ribbon blender. an ordinary mixer. It just put the peat in and your green waste on top and blend them together.
Yep.
Yep.
Okay.
So just like mixing a cake.
big Breville. Yeah. Mohammed has asked, was it cooked out at the end of each growing cycle?
Yes.
The room was cooked out?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes. Bill asks, what kind of chemicals were used in the trial?
Okay, so we didn't use any fungicides.
No. We kept it clean, and the only thing that was added to it was calcium carbonate.
Yep, right here. So again, we've got green compost has a very broad kind of structure and texture. Indeed it does, as we discovered. Can you specify what type you're talking about?
Okay. So I guess I can send through a product sheet perhaps after this of one of the products that we used from A&L. And so it's got some details in there about the texture and things like that. So it's a good point. And I guess I'd raise the point that the products we used were all quite different. But what they were sort of roughly based on, I can send you that. I can send that out to everyone after this.
Right. And then we also had, do you think that spent mushroom compost could be used, from Brian? Which I guess it can, but it comes down to the salt content, doesn't it? Often.
I tried it in the early 70s and left it out the ape in the weather for 12 months, and I brought it in. I pasteurised it at 40 degrees C in the aerated truck body.
Right. And that worked?
Worked very well.
Worked very well.
Moonlight mushrooms used only spent mushroom compost in their casing in, I think it was the 70s and 80s, but I don't know what become of it since then.
Yes. Well, I know certainly in Iran and places which don't have easy access to peat, they do use spent mushroom compost. And then Brian has asked, is this presentation going to be available afterwards?
Absolutely. So
yes,
it's a recorded webinar, so we'll send out the recording and also the presentation for you.
Yep. Okay, and that brings us to the end of the questions, and indeed our time is up. So, yes, please, same time, same place next week, and you can hear all about the our recent review of factors improving mushroom whiteness.
All right.
So I hope to see you then. Yep. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks, everyone. Bye for now.